Well, like I said, you're on the phone. I guess I had some officers contact you at Super 8 on March the 9th, I think it was, real early in the morning.
Yeah, I think so.
And so that's what we're here to talk about. Why don't you tell me what transpired there?
Well, we were inside talking, and you know, we heard a bang on the door. I honestly didn't know who it was. Couldn't see through the keyhole or the peephole. And so, you know, the young man I was with, I know, has, you know, I've known him for, we've been talking. He's come to the coffee shop that I operate a couple times. Shoot, I've even had him over to my house, played video games before. Had no idea. Told me when I first met him that he was 20. And so when they first got there, I didn't know what the issue was. You know, didn't know if it was, you know, somebody trying to get in or what. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I asked them, somebody, they said it was a wellness check or something like that, and I said, hey, I'm fine. And they were persistent, and then I could finally see a badge, one of them. And then they said that there was a minor inside the room. Obviously, I had no idea when I first met this young man. He told me he was 20 years old. Like I said, we've been talking on the phone for a while. He, in fact, for a few months, even told me that he went to California to try to be in the music industry or something. So that was when I opened the door. It just didn't make any sense to me why, you know, there'd be a, you know.
Police there.
Actually, what I asked him was, I said, are you a minor? And he said, no, let me go talk to them. And I said, okay. And he went out there, and that's, you know, I don't know what they talked about, but I asked him to check his ID. So again, I'd never even thought to ask him for his ID. There's no reason to. So anyway, I guess after that, one of the men, Sergeant something, I can't remember his last name, he's bald. He lectured me quite a deal. At that point, I was, you know, again, blood pressure. I had to sit down, couldn't even really, I don't even honestly remember what I said to him, a little bit, I think, and I just needed to not have a stroke. So I was caught off guard by that. I think they asked me at some point if they could search the room. I had my computer bag with me, and one of the men searched my computer bag as well as the room. As far as I know, there was nothing found. That was that.
Okay. So they said they, pardon me, they said they smelled weed in the room. Did were y'all smoking weed or anything?
I was not smoking weed.
Was there any in there?
No.
Okay.
Again, I asked them to search. They wanted to search my bag. So I don't remember. I think he needed a place to stay for the night. Mm-hmm. I think he had a bag with him. I don't know if they searched that.
Okay.
I did not.
So did you stay there all night after the cops left? Or?
No, I left a little while later.
About what time?
I have no idea.
Okay. But you didn't stay until in the morning?
I wanted to make sure that I was okay
mm-hmm.
to leave.
Okay.
And that was off.
So you say how long you known the guy?
It's been definitely over a year.
Okay. What do you know him by? What's his name?
He's been over to my coffee shop a couple times. I know that he had been arrested for drug dealing in the past.
Mm-hmm.
I know that he had dropped out of high school. You know, he was trying to get a GED. I was trying to help him through that. In fact, when we first met, I was trying to help him study and things like that for the GED. And then when I lost contact with him for 4 or 5 months, when he went to California or wherever, I just assumed that he had, you know, I didn't know that's where he went.
Well, how did y'all meet?
At the coffee shop.
I'm
pretty sure of that.
But what coffee shop are you talking?
That's my guy. I own a coffee shop.
What is it?
It's called Holy Grounds Coffee.
Okay.
And 8613 Southwestern.
Okay.
And how we met. I honestly don't remember. It's the only place I probably would have met the guy. So anyway, he's been over a couple times there. When he came back, you know, he was, well, in fact, he told me he wanted to go be an anesthesiologist or something. And I said, well, you've got to get, you can't go without a high school diploma. You can't do anything without a high school diploma. And so, you know, I know that the day after the incident happened, he was going to test for the GED. Strongly encouraged him to do that. The night that he called me, he said, you just need to get out of his house. I'm assuming I thought he had told me that he lived with some friends. And he had told me in the past that, you know, it was hard for him to get clean because he was always with his friends that were, you know, living with him. And so, you know, when he called and said he needed to get out of there, you know, that he had to test the next day, then the choice was to bring him over to my house, which I don't think my wife would have appreciated that very much. She probably would have been okay with it, but I just figured it'd be easier just to get him a place. And then we decided to talk.
How do you text him, or how do y'all communicate?
It's usually phone calls.
Phone calls?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's interesting because on his tablet he has a conversation that he says he had with you using an app called Kick. You know what that is?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, there's a pretty lengthy conversation on his tablet that he says is with a guy that is you, that he that is the online, or the kick ID is Jamie Tilly. And you told officers that night that's what you're online.
He called me Jamie.
Uh-huh.
And I'm not sure why.
Okay. And anyways, so we've got a conversation between him and this Jamie Tilly about, he says, I need money for spring break. Jamie Tilly says, I don't really have any legitimate things I need help with right now. Would you be interested in sexual stuff? He says, yes. This goes on about how I come get you, blah, blah, blah. We go on. He says, he starts calling this guy Daddy. He says, hurry up, Daddy. I'm super horny. Hey, keep me updated because I want you bad, Daddy. The guy named Jamie Tilly says, I'm going to be like a good little boy if you keep calling me Daddy. This goes on and on and on and on. Well, then it gets to the end. It says, okay, I'll be down the street a couple houses in about 10 minutes or so. He says, okay, let me know so I have an idea. Then that person says, I-35 about to exit at 4th Street. And then it says, I'm here. Well, we've got a witness, pardon me, we've got a witness that sees him get in a white Grand Cherokee, and they follow that white Grand Cherokee to the hotel, first to 4th and Eastern, at the gas station, and then to the Circle K.
Yeah, this is the gas station.
Yeah, at the gas station, and then to the Super 8, where the guy in the white Jeep Cherokee and him go in, check into a room, and then go back out and go into room 120. All right, and they sit there until the police show up, where she then calls his dad, and he calls calls the police, and the police show up there to 120, knock on the door. And then you come out. So, again, I ask, you told officers that you had online identity, Jamie. This guy, and he was talking to you. We got a witness picking him up at the same time that this message was sent saying, I'm here. So, I kind of got to say that Jamie Tilly's you.
It's not me.
It's not you.
We communicated by phone. There was no sexual intention that night.
Okay. You got anything there, huh? So how did you meet?
coffee shop.
Okay. So, like, he just walks in, you guys strike up a conversation, become friends?
Yeah, that's happened many times.
Invite him over to your house. Has your wife met him?
I think so.
Okay. Now, you say he's come to your house several times to play video games?
I think just once.
Come to your house once to play video games? And then you guys met at the coffee shop a couple of times? Mm-hmm. Okay. What if I said that he told you you guys met through a Craigslist ad the very first time? Yeah. When he posted in Casual Encounters?
No.
Okay.
Is he legitimately underage?
Yeah.
And he was the first time that you met him, and
he's,
I said...
16.
I asked him, I said, hey, does he know how old you were? And he said, yeah, he knows, because we had a discussion about it, and at first he was uncomfortable with it, but then he finally got over it.
In this conversation, it says, she needs me to go to the store for her. My 3-year-old is sick. That's one of the things I've been dealing with tonight. We're not going to have enough time. Can we get together tomorrow, after 1? I'll get a hotel room or something, if that would make it easier. Goes on talking about my coffee shop. I'll be alone in about 10 minutes at my coffee shop. He says, can I help you with anything for spring break? Again, you said just customers, but I'll leave in here close to 8. Okay. I'll be your slave. That sounds nice. I mean, we go on. And
how old is your youngest child?
5 months.
Okay. So he's telling me that when he first met you through Craigslist, that he had posted an ad in Casual Encounters, and that he had a lot of responses for it, but that you said that you wanted him to mess around with your wife while you watched. He said that he showed up to do that, or you guys got together and started talking about that. He found out your wife was pregnant, and then said that it never happened because she was pregnant. So here's the deal, Ralph. You and I both know what the truth is, and the truth is not what you're telling us. We're not saying you're a bad guy. We're not saying you set out thinking that this is some 15-year-old kid you're going to go bang. We're not saying that. We're saying, hell, maybe you didn't know how old he was. I don't know. I think you probably did based on what he's telling me, but things are what they are. Tell us the truth. Get it out there. Let's get this over with. Get this behind us so we can all move on.
Telling you that.
No, you're not. You're telling us part of what happened, but you're not telling us what's going on.
You told the officers there that you had an online identity of Jamie.
He's talking about, you talk about in these texts when this kick account about your kids and your kid being sick and your coffee shop and that you got customers left and that you close at 8. I mean, it's clearly you. It's clearly
you. And we've got a witness that put you there. When you
I absolutely picked him up.
When you say I'm here, the witness is waiting down the street because she thought it was jacked up. She thought it was jacked up that he wouldn't tell her where he was going or anything like that. So she sits down the street and waits. And then she sees him going to the Super 8 Hotel with you. And then she gets scared and wondering what the heck's going on. So she calls the police. Or calls his dad. And who in turn calls us. So here's the deal. we're trying to give you an opportunity, all right, to help yourself out here. All right. We have a... electronic. I mean, we have the device. These are just photos of it. We actually have downloaded the entire device now. So we have everything that y'all said that night. Everything. The thing about it is that tablet, once you sent the message saying I'm here, that tablet was never on the internet again. So the kit conversation couldn't delete. So we have the entire conversation. But
you can look at it.
Yeah, you can look at it. We have the entire conversation because it never hit the network again. This is a bad deal. This is prostitution with a minor, prostitution within 1,000 feet of a church, which are both felonies, and then transporting for the purposes of prostitution, which is a misdemeanor.
I'm telling you, that's not me.
That clearly is you. That's Ralph, that's a lie. You're lying to us right now. That's clearly you. No one else, daughter sick, coffee shop, I'm here and you're there. That's clearly you.
I don't know who else you could have been talking to.
Well, I agree with you. Nobody.
You're at a
coffee shop and has a kid, sick kid, and all this stuff.
And showed up.
It's you. He's, and here's the deal. He says it's you that he's talking to.
You show up with condoms. He shows up with lotion. I mean,
that's not true at all.
Yeah, there was condoms in your bag. The cop saw them.
That's just not absolutely not true. I did not show up there for any sexual thing.
Well, then there's also weed that was in a green plastic container. Marijuana that was in a green plastic container with labels from Colorado that was in the room.
Did you ever touch that bottle?
No.
So there's no way your fingerprints will be on it?
No.
Okay.
Okay, because we have the bottle.
I don't know what to tell you.
He says, matter of fact, what? He says when the police knocked on the door that y'all were both smoking marijuana.
He said that he brought a gram when you brought a gram, and you guys rolled a huge blunt, and that you guys were planning on messing around, it just hadn't got there yet. And that he was going to do you a favor by whatever it was you guys were going to do, and that you were going to do him a favor by kicking him some money for spring break. Ralph, like I said, we don't think you're a bad guy. We think you made a bad decision. There's a big difference.
I just don't know why you would do that. I honestly don't know.
Because it's true.
It's not true.
I mean, he's 17.
He's 17. About that too.
Okay, well... Well, for all practical purposes, let's say he did lie about that, all right? Jamie Tilly is you, and I can prove it. So, at minimum, you met with a guy at a hotel to pay him for sex. Within 1,000 feet of the church, which is a felony in itself. So, at minimum, that's what it is. All right? At minimum. So, you know, I'm giving you an opportunity here. And he told me I shouldn't, but I am. I'm giving you an opportunity to do it, to take responsibility for it and make it a little bit easier on yourself. If you don't want to take it, that's fine. Okay? I can tell you what I'm going to do tomorrow. All right? First thing tomorrow morning, I'm taking this case to the Clinton County District Attorney's Office. Okay? I'm going to suggest that they file charges for solicitation of a minor, prostitution within 1,000 feet of a church, and transporting for the purposes of prostitution. Okay? And then they're going to decide whether or not they're going to file charges or not. Obviously, I've given you an opportunity to help yourself out, to tell us what happened. Everything that I'm telling you, I can prove beyond a shadow of a doubt. So, I know that's why we're sitting here so strongly telling you you're lying, because we can prove the Jamie Tilly identity. We can prove that identity is you. I mean, amazing things that we can do with electronics and stuff like that, that we can recover and stuff like that with warrants and everything. So I'm telling you right now, with beyond a shadow of a doubt, that's you. And if you want to move forward from this with keep saying that's not you, then that's fine. But I don't want to be here not giving you an opportunity to set it straight and tell the truth.
It doesn't sound like anything I say is going to help.
Okay. I mean, the truth helps.
And just so you know, that you guys also exchanged dick pics at one point. And when you, hopefully you didn't take a picture of your dick with your phone, because that's going to tag it whenever you send it to somebody.
No, I don't. I don't do that.
Okay.
Well, I wouldn't. I don't understand why he would do this. I really don't.
Yeah. And he said he knows you because, like you're saying, coffee shop, all that. Said you guys smoked weed on the second floor of the coffee shop in the past.
I just don't understand why he would do that.
He has nothing to gain from this.
Except screwing me.
How does that help him?
I have no idea.
Why would that screw him?
On probation or whatever.
He has no idea who you are. He thinks your name is Jamie. He has no idea what your real name is. None. He referred to you as Jamie the whole time I'm talking to him. So it's not like he's going to get anything from any of this. It's not like he gains anything from this. Have you got your phone with you right now?
No.
Where is it at?
Honestly, I lost it.
Lost your phone. Because you and I both know it would be on that phone.
There's nothing on that phone.
So other than kicks, how did you communicate with him? Did you email him?
I don't think I've ever had his email address.
Okay.
But mostly it was in person, I'll be honest.
Okay.
Anytime that we got together, it was, you know, like I said, he came to the house once. And we've only, you know, met in person maybe two or three times.
Prior to the evening that we're talking about, how much sexual stuff had you guys done together?
Nothing.
So that was going to be the first time?
We weren't doing anything.
I know, not when we got there, you weren't, but that was the plan for that evening.
No.
Clearly it was.
Sir, I'm telling you it wasn't.
I don't have any legitimate work for you, and you're interested in sexual stuff.
Would you be interested in any sexual stuff? He says yes. Then it gets worse on down figure, as far as talking about it. It says, I mean, at one point, I don't know, I may have said this earlier, I'm going to wait if you keep calling me daddy. He goes, yes, daddy, please.
Did you ever have sex with him?
No, never.
Did you ever give him a hand job?
No.
Did he ever give you a hand job?
I've never even seen him naked or even asked.
So, this was going to be the first time that any of that had ever happened.
No, sir.
Well, you can't help with this stuff. You can definitely help with my stuff. That's another statement. I'm just going through here reading what you wrote. Because I can prove that you wrote it. I mean, that's you. So I'm just letting you know what's coming down the pipe.
So how did you, if that's not you, how did you contact him last night, or that night?
I think he called me.
He didn't have a phone.
Sir, he called me. That's all I can say. I don't know.
How did he know that you were outside?
He called me, and I told him I was on my way. I told him I'd be there in a certain amount of time, and I got there.
Did you use this phone that you've lost?
I mean, it's the only phone I had.
Okay. What was that number?
I can't remember the last four.
Of the phone that you lost?
Oh, no, my phone was the number I gave you earlier. That's my cell phone.
Mm-hmm. And that's the one that's lost?
Well, I use Hangouts for Google numbers. I've always used them for all of my businesses, and so it would have been.
Explain that to me. What does that mean? Like when you, it's like when you call him or he calls you. He calls you on the number,
yeah.
And that goes to your cell phone.
Mm-hmm.
Via Google Hangouts?
Yeah, it was like, it's a forwarded number.
A Google Voice number?
No, it goes directly to my number.
Okay. And so you called him back and said, I'm here?
Right.
Okay. And what number would you have called?
I think I just told him I'd be there in 20 minutes or whatever.
And then he saw you when you got down the street?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, as far as I know, you keep saying down the street. I went to the house that he told me to go to.
What house is that? You remember?
And, you know, that's where he told me to meet him. And, you know, I'm trying to think of, I called him when I got there. I don't think I did. No, I didn't, because I saw him on the porch.
Okay. And you think that what you've told us today is going to make sense to a jury of your peers?
All I can say is the truth, sir.
And you're not. I agree. All you can say to help yourself out is the truth, but you're not doing that.
So, this 219 number, you say you lost the handset?
After I called you, I apparently have left it on top of my car or something. I've tried to find it because I needed to call someone else.
So you just recently lost it?
Yeah, I talked to you when I was about to leave my house. And I went back and looked on the ground.
Anything else?
Nope. That is it. We gave it a shot.
Yep. Do you have any questions?
The conversation that you have there, how lengthy is it? How long does it go? Is it just one night? Is it more than a week? Is it a month?
This one that we have right here is just that night. But we have others.
Other what?
Conversations.
In what form? Same, the same messenger?
Huh?
The same messenger?
I don't know. I'm going to have to get with... We'll have it at... I think he said four this afternoon. So we took his device. What we did is we took his device. We took... There was two devices. We took them. We forensically... we have a guy who forensically examined them. Then what they do is they take everything... Everything off of it. Now, if it leads us to another device, if we get a search warrant or a court order or to another account, say, for instance, in this particular thing, this Jamie Tilly, all right, we can get the IP address that's used, all the IP addresses that's used with that account, right, and we can track that IP address back to a handset. Like, so, say, for instance, the IP address that he uses will track back to a network that he uses. If it's a wireless network, then it'll be that one and stuff like that. So we have several devices that we're looking at now.
Okay. Not sure what all that means, but
his devices. We're getting everything off of the two devices that we have of his. We're taking all that stuff off, alright? And our guy's going through them one by one and sending us different IP addresses to look at.
What it comes down to is the reason we have those conversations is that when we turned the Kindle on, those are the ones on there, so we took pictures of those, and then we gave them to the forensics guy. And what he'll do is he'll go get more in depth, but that way he and I don't screw it up by trying to fiddle with the damn thing.
So we have more conversations. I just don't know what platform they're on. Because all we did is what was up on the tab. We took pictures of what was up on the tab up then. So we have more conversations. I just don't know what platform they're on. I'll know tonight because he'll be done with both tablets today. So.
And so you don't know how long this conversation has been going on or anything right now?
Correct.
Yeah.
So basically all that can happen is at this point is that we get more evidence about what's going on. Because there's nowhere to go from here. But more to add to it.
I can find. I know you guys don't believe me, and I'm not going to try to convince you otherwise unless I have something to show you, and I just don't know.
I find it hard to believe that you magically lost your phone on the way over here as well.
It's not the first time, sir.
Well, and just look at it, okay. Take all this crap in the last in this conversation that we've had out of it, all right? So just put yourself in my shoes, okay? So you got a guy who gets caught in a room with a minor, or in a hotel room with a minor. And he comes in and talks to us, knowing that he's had a conversation with this minor on an electronic device, all right? Probably his phone, because of the way he was at the he was at the store, he was at the guy's store, he was in his car, so more than likely it was on a guy on his phone. So you're coming in blind, not knowing
also
other...
extremely nervous.
Well, I got you. I know, but put yourself in my shoes. You're coming in this blind, only knowing that we're going to want to talk to you about, you know, the hotel room, and, you know, all of a sudden you come in and you don't have a phone, and you I know you live with your phone. You have to. So that's just strange to us, you know?
Is your phone is your phone on you right now?
No, it's not.
Is it in your car?
No.
Can I look in your car?
Sure.
Okay.
When did you drive up here tonight?
Sorry?
When did you drive up here today?
When?
What? What vehicle did you drive up here?
My car.
What is your
the Jeep?
Oh, the white Jeep. Mm-hmm. Turkey? What year is it?
Have you talked to him since that night?
No. I honestly would have loved to have talked to his parents. I had no idea that he was still with his parents. I wouldn't have been with a minor.
Well, you knew that he was kicked out of high school.
Yeah, I knew. No, I knew that. Well, he told me he dropped out of high school.
Okay, you knew that he dropped out of high school.
Mm-hmm.
And that he was trying to get his GED.
Right.
How old did you think he was?
20. When we met, he told me he was 20.
Okay.
And, you know, he's told me. Guys, I'm this is why this is just so, I don't understand why you would do this. Because that's all we've ever talked about. Is just life and just trying to get him better, I guess. I had no idea he lived with his parents.
Why'd you tell the officers there that you had an online identity by Jamie?
I didn't say that. I said that he's called me Jamie.
Well... I don't mean you did, because we got body cameras and I actually saw it. So, I mean, they were talking to him, they were talking to you, and you said you had that you went online or had an online identity of Jamie. That's it. You didn't say Tilly, the last one, but you said Jamie.
I don't remember that, sir.
Okay.
Man, you made a bad decision. You know, that doesn't mean you're a bad person. It just means you made a bad decision. It's not the end of the world.
And if I can't prove otherwise, that it is the end of the world. And I can't think of any other proof that I can show you.
There's nothing. Because there's no... I mean...
There absolutely would be.
What we have is the truth.
If I had phone calls or if I had...
What you don't, because they don't exist. What we have is the truth. You know it. You know that's
I never would have thought to have to record a phone call or anything with a guy. I mean, he's...
It was recorded. That's what we've got pictures of. The conversation was recorded. I mean, that is so clearly you. You and I both know that's you. Anyone we show that to is going to know that's you.
Well, that's the problem.
It's the truth. What I'm saying, the problem is that for some reason, you think that if you stick your head in the sand and ignore it, it's going to go away. It's not. Your best bet is to tell us the truth, tell us what happened, and then move on from this. Make this a bump in the road, not the road. I mean, it's that simple, really. This is not a defining moment. This is just a moment. No, this is you've had other things happen in your life that were awful at the time, and then now that you look back on them, they're still awful, but they didn't change who you were. They didn't make... It didn't... It's a bump. That's all it is. It doesn't change the fact that you're a good person, that you care about your family. None of that changes. But the reason you're having trouble thinking of something to say is because, you know, there's nothing you can say.
I'm having trouble thinking of something to say.
You're trying to decide whether or not you should tell us what happened.
No, I told you everything.
Okay. And no phone on you, no phone in your car?
No.
Do you mind if I patch you that real quick?
I said, hell, I should have said that before you sit down. I'm going to walk down in the car with you.